Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome back to Administrative Static. This is Mark Chenoweth with John Vecchione, and I am pleased to have back with us as a repeat guest on the program my colleague Caleb Kruckenberg from the New Civil Liberties Alliance. Caleb, how are you today?
I'm doing very well. How are you?
I'm doing great, and I'm glad to have you with us because in a recent podcast segment, we talked about the administrative search problem and the abuse of administrative power that happens in this context of search. And we were talking about John's fishing case down in the Gulf of Mexico, and we were talking about the some of the cases that you've been working on with automatic license plate readers and how there are invasions of privacy and violations of the Fourth Amendment that are taking place without a warrant, without probable cause, and so forth. But you have a really interesting case involving Bitcoin that I think is pretty similar to some of these other kinds of abuses of administrative power and abuses of administrative search. Can you tell our audience what's happening in that case?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, I think the Internal Revenue Service is probably one of the great villains of administrative searches. And, you know, that's probably not unsurprising to people that the IRS is really bad about this. But, you know, what they've been doing is they basically go around and they can get your financial records really for anything, you know, without any kind of specific showing, without getting a warrant, without doing anything like that. And they've been targeting people who have Bitcoin or other digital currencies. And they have been gathering financial records and other personal records of people who use digital currencies. And when I say personal records, I mean like home addresses, social security numbers, the addresses, names, social security numbers of people on the other side of a Bitcoin transaction, like if I'm paying someone. And they've been collecting all this information, and apparently with no process at all. You know, the IRS has the legal ability under a statute to seek a subpoena, but it looks like they haven't even been doing that. They've just been gathering Bitcoin records just for their own purposes. And
let's take one step back. Some of our audience may not know what Bitcoin is. Can you give a sort of concise explanation of what this digital currency is?
Bitcoin or other digital currencies, it's kind of takes the idea of, you know, paper money represents value, and it pushes it even farther into the digital world. And so there's no such thing as a Bitcoin that you can use in your hand, but hold in your hand, but it's basically a line of code. But it's a line of code that is very, very secure because it takes more than one computer that to host the code. And so it's this very secure sort of digital item that represents value. And it's over the years, it's become very valuable. Bitcoin is now, you know, one Bitcoin is now worth, you know, more than $10,000. And what it does for people is, particularly if you live somewhere where your currency is very unstable, you can invest in Bitcoin, and it has a set value, you know, worldwide. And in that sense, it's not really that different from, say, investing in gold or other commodities. But it's just kind of a new type of money. But it's not
backed with any assets.
It's not backed with any assets. And right. Unfortunately, the government has been very suspicious of it. And they've just decided, basically, if you use digital currencies, you're suspicious. because you have to be up to no good in their eyes, because why would you want to use a digital currency that could be anonymous, where you potentially could move money around the world without having to tell them about it? And so
isn't cash anonymous? Haven't people used cash anonymously for lots of years?
Yeah. Well, and the IRS, you know, they have.
But you can't use cash online, right? It's hard to use cash online.
Right, and there are limits, right? I mean, if a lot of people may be familiar, if you go to your bank and you deposit $10,000 in cash, whether you know it or not, the bank has to file a report with the government. They have to file a currency transaction report. Or, you know, if you transfer $50,000 in cash to somebody, the bank is going to report on that to the IRS and to the Treasury. So the government, you know, they're in their eyes, if you're using digital currencies, then we're suspicious because we think you're trying to avoid our regulations and we think you must be up to no good.
Or trying to avoid taxes or something like that.
Something. Right. And so basically what the government did is they went around and they collected massive amounts of information from people who had Bitcoin or other digital currencies. And this, it's back in the fall of 2019, they sent letters to thousands of people saying, we obtained your financial records from somewhere, we're not going to tell you where, and we think you didn't pay your taxes, and we're going to come after you because we know you've been using virtual currencies. And
but they didn't really know that client, these people hadn't paid their taxes. They just knew that they had virtual
currencies.
No, not at all. Yeah.
Exactly. So we know that the IRS somehow gathered information that people have been using virtual currencies enough that they could find people and send them letters, these threatening letters saying, we're going to come after you. We could have a criminal enforcement action against you for unreported income, all these things. And our client got one of these letters. But, he paid his taxes. The IRS is completely wrong about that. But what it showed to him, to our client,
this is Jim Harper? Is that
yes,
the client's
yes,
name?
Yes, our client, okay. Jim Harper.
Yeah.
It told him, guess what? The IRS has been collecting your information, your private information, about your use of Bitcoin.
And why is that a concern?
Really interesting. Well, and what's really interesting in this specific context is for Bitcoin, you can't just put it in a normal bank. You have to use what's called an exchange. And it's a company that basically acts like a digital bank. They hold your Bitcoin and then they do transactions for you. And there's a bunch of them. One of the best known is called Coinbase. But when you sign up with these banks, every single one of them has an agreement with you that says that we're not going to turn over your information to the government unless they come with a warrant or a valid court order. They're very clear about that. And
that's what the
Mr.
Constitution
Harper,
requires, is that if you
exactly.
if the government's going to search you, they have to go to a judge and they have to have probable cause. They have to go to a judge and they have to get that judge to sign a search warrant to enable the search. And so this prevents
right.
things like warrantless searches or searches that lack all probable cause, like sounds like might have happened here.
Yeah, well, a blanket search, right, of just everybody in the country who's involved in one kind of activity, which is using digital currency, which is legal. There's nothing illegal about Bitcoin.
It would be like saying, for example, it would be like saying, we think that all owners of coin-operated car washes are avoiding taxes, and therefore, without a warrant, we're just going to go collect information about every coin-operated car wash in the country.
And every transaction you've done. So every bank statement, the other side of the bank statement, we're going to get all that information, just in case, just to make
without
sure you didn't do
cause.
Anything wrong.
Yeah.
Exactly. And
but usually
so
you have to have particularized
really
suspicion, don't you? I mean, I'm saying this for our audience's benefit. I know you're a former federal defense attorney, former federal public defender. So you've probably defended people who've had search warrants executed against them before. But you're supposed to have particularized suspicion in these cases. There's no such thing as a blanket search warrant, is there?
No. And, you know, if you actually look at the history of the Fourth Amendment, you look at the history of administrative searches, actually the Supreme Court was very specific about this for decades. And the court protected people's papers. If you look at the text of the Fourth Amendment, that's one of the things that's listed, right, are your papers. And the idea was the founders, the people who wrote the Fourth Amendment and the Supreme Court who interpreted it for years, everybody agreed, what we don't want is we don't want the government coming into your house, opening your desk, and looking through your papers, looking through your records, looking through your financial statements. That is forbidden. And the only excuse that the government can have for doing that is they go to a magistrate, they go to a judge, and they say, we have a very particular reason. We think they did something wrong, and we need to see what's in that drawer, what's in their papers. And they get a warrant, and then they can look. But that was a very specific prohibition that was a major component of our Constitution.
They get a warrant if the judge agrees that they've shown probable cause, right?
Exactly. If they go into court and say, we think he committed a crime, here's the crime, here's why we think he committed it. I mean, it's
right.
You know, you can't just say, like, well, Bitcoin is suspicious. That's nowhere near good enough.
Right.
But what's happened is over the years, they get these subpoena powers. They get these administrative subpoenas that they start issuing. And the oversight just falls away, and the court has been very hands off, and they say, "Well, you can subpoena whatever you want." And
well, because they trust themselves, right? That's the view of these administrative agencies.
Right.
We're trying to enforce the law, so you should trust us. We're the government. You should trust us. Well, pardon me if I don't trust the IRS, but it'll be interesting to see how this case develops. And thank you for being with us on the program to discuss it today, Caleb. Really appreciate it.
Sure.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Administrative Static. I'm John Vecchione. And in a disappointing move, the Supreme Court has just turned down a case called Arthrex, which was hotly watched by the patent bar. But it has a very, it was going to determine a very important point in administrative law, which is, what are these patent judges? Are they constitutionally appointed? And that has been a big point of debate. And certainly we at NCLA have been pressing that you can't have a valid administrative hearing without a validly appointed administrative law judge. What we have in this case is that the patent judges are, in our view, and in the view of one side here, is that they are principal officers. They've got final decision-making power. So that final decision-making power is the key to whether or not you are a principal officer, and then you have to be appointed and confirmed by the Senate. So the court has turned this down and kicked the can down the road, but it's going to come up, and it comes up in a bunch of different ways. But what I'd like to address, one of the arguments in these cases for these judges are, hey, look, there's a lot of administrative proceedings now, right? It's not the 18th century. We can't just have Article III judges. Those are the judges that you normally think of as federal judges. They're appointed and confirmed by the Senate, and that's why we have big fights in the Supreme Court every time in the Senate. But it's all the district court judges, all the appellate court judges. They're appointed, and they, all the federal cases that go to the federal courts, they are the ones who adjudicate them. But then all Social Security, all patent law type cases, all these go to administrative law judges at the Securities and Exchange Commission. A lot of security cases go before them. The FTC has an administrative law judge. That's the Federal Trade Commission. So there are tons of these non-Article III judges. And the, you know, the legal construct has always been, well, they're not really principal officers because they don't have the real final decision because it gets appealed and for a bunch of other reasons. But Mark, what I'd like to talk about is this. There's an argument out there, and it lurks out there, and sometimes it's made very explicitly, that the Constitution couldn't ever contemplate our modern life. And therefore, the idea that all of these administrative law judges have to be, if they're going to make final decisions, are going to be have to be constitutionally appointed. That's just too much. That'll take too much of the Senate's time, and it'll be too many, and there's all these other problems.
Well, that's right, because folks say that the most precious commodity in Washington, D.C. is Senate floor time, and the Senate likes to do things other than spend all of its time on confirming judges and confirming other appointees, and so they chafe at having additional appointments, confirmation type work to do. I can just tell you from when I was on Capitol Hill during the time that the America Invents Act was passed on the House side. I was on the House side, but obviously it passed through both houses before getting to President Obama's desk. But it was a bone of contention. And part of the idea here was to make sure that there wouldn't have to be Senate confirmations because nobody on the Senate wanted to spend more time on confirming these judges. That's whether that's the right constitutional viewpoint to have is a completely separate question. And I think what you're talking about, but in terms of what the Senate meant to happen in the bill, I think it's very clear they meant to not create more work for themselves going forward.
Well, let's talk about that a little bit, Mark, in that they could have just had the head of the patent office. And we've talked about this before. I think you're the one who told me that patents used to be confirmed by like Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin.
Yeah, Edmund Randolph, I think, was on the original, and Henry Knox, if I remember, the original three patent board members. Pretty intimidating crew.
Right. So it is possible that you could just have a procedure where the head of the patent board gave his views on whatever decision these officers, these judges wouldn't have the last word, as it would, and they'd arguably not be principal officers. And that's a term in the Constitution. That's why this matters, because the whole structure of the Constitution is that the real decision makers have to be responsible to the people through their representatives. And in a way, administrative law judges are not, particularly the more protections you put in.
That's just it, right? So if you had the you can't have two layers of tenure protection either. So if you were to make the head of the patent office the boss of these administrative patent judges, if you were to make that person presidentially appointed and Senate confirmed, then you couldn't have tenure protection for the APJs themselves, unless you didn't have tenure protection for that presidentially appointed Senate confirmed position, because you could have the tenure protection at either layer, but not at both layers.
So I guess that point is there are Supreme Court cases that say that you can have one layer of protection from the executive, but you can't have two. That's a little too much. They have to have some control over this. Is that what we're getting at?
That's right. That's right. That was a case called Free Enterprise Fund v. Public Company Accounting Oversight Board, that the president needs to be able to fire people essentially in the executive branch. And so you can't have two different layers between him and the person he's trying to fire, at least not two layers that have tenure protection.
And the reason he has to be able to fire them is because he has the duty to take care that the laws are faithfully executed. And since the president can't go around listening to every patent case, and he can't go around listening to every Social Security case, and the people he puts in those positions have got to be responsible to him because the duty is ultimately his constitutionally. Do I have that right?
That's exactly right. Yep. And so, I think that, go ahead.
And so so some of the things, so a lot of folks who, in my view, don't want to follow the constitutional procedures do say things like, well, we can't, there's no way to do this. And what happened in the Arthrex case is the lower court just made up its own remedy. But Mark and I, our view is that that remedy has to be created by Congress. They either have to say that these protections, these for-cause protections aren't there, or the head of the patent office can make the ruling, or at least these rulings aren't final. Somebody else who is congressionally appointed, presidentially appointed and congressionally confirmed, has to make a final decision. So, but how that's all done is really for Congress. It's not for the courts to fix the problem.
That's what was surprising to me, John, is, and I don't know if that was your chief concern, but the Federal Circuit here fixed the law, right? They came up with what they thought was a solution that fixed it and rewrote the statute. And I thought the Supreme Court would take issue with a lower court rewriting a statute, but they didn't.
Yeah, you know, I always read that they didn't take strong issue because they didn't take the case, but we don't know. Sometimes, who knows why they make decisions sometimes. Sometimes they just think that there's some factual thing they don't want to deal with, or, you know, who knows why they turn this down. I don't think this is a matter of no concern to them. It's just not as much of a front burner issue as I suppose it is with us, because I agree with you. I thought they were going to take this. And
well, my worry is that you have a bunch of justices up there who don't care that much about business cases. And if that's the case, we're going to have a problem for a long time, because these business cases are very important. There are lots of decisions turn on these sorts of constitutional questions for the companies involved.
And, you know, this is an interesting thing, I think, for our audience, is that we both and NCLA are very focused on the constitutional questions and how we have to make sure that we don't basically traduce or screw up our constitutional structure, because that leads to all kinds of problems, as we've seen over and over in this country's history. But the business community, although there are many lawyers in the business community who are also keyed in on these arguments, they have a practical problem. They want to get their patents confirmed. They don't want it to be long. They want efficiency. They're also afraid of my solution of just having the head of the patent office, the Thomas Jeffersons and the Henry Knox's confirmed stuff, because they're worried that their patents will be influenced by politics. So they often don't want any of the solutions. They kind of like the old, let's give it to this guy. He knows a lot about patents, and we're happy with his judgment, regardless of whether or not he's removable by the president. So this is how, in my view, bad law gets made, because there are important business reasons to go the other way. So you often see that that business arguments are different from constitutional law arguments, even though, of course, they'll use them whenever they can. But you have a big fight. I mean, they're the amicus, meaning the friends of the court briefs in this, of people who weren't involved but wanted to say something, were pretty – there were a lot of them. So,
well, this issue isn't going away either. So it's not like by not taking the case that the court has solved the problem. It's just kicked the can down the road, and a lot of people are going to suffer in the meantime.
I think that's right. And the other thing is we'll have that big problem we always have is, let's say they come out next year with a new rule. What happens to all the decisions of these guys who are making their decisions, I presume, in good faith? They're not constitutionally appointed, but, you know, I'm sure they're trying to do their best job, and everybody's relying to the tune of billions of dollars on whatever they decide, whether or not, you know, this is a new item that can be patented and protected. So I think what we have here is something the Supreme Court's going to have to take, and we all have to fight the idea that the Constitution's outmoded. It is not, and there are ways to do this correctly. And we'll be back in a moment.